So I'm back here with Helen Borovskaja. Welcome back, Helen. And we're going to be talking about, we've been talking about this off stage for a bit, about this, you know, because you're looking to get British citizenship. So we're going to be talking about that, but also about this, you know, for those people that are worried or still need to do it, about this settled status, the settlement scheme that EU citizens have to currently go through. I think it got till next June, actually, 2021.
Yes, it's a new form. Most people had to fill in to remain the... I forgot the name of it. The indefinite leave to remain.
Yeah, leave to remain,
yes. That form. And at first it was about £60 to fill in if it was the same form. Then it became for free. So my whole family and everyone I know who's from EU has kind of filled it in. Now there's a new form that you have to fill in. So I've decided, because I want to stay in UK, get a mortgage and have my life here and continue living.
Which is great. Very welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I should just get a passport. It's easiest kind of choice.
And how easy is this scheme? Because everyone's heard a lot about this scheme. It's all online. I mean, the big contentious issue seems to be, because we've got a family member, my wife's mum's gone through it. So they don't have any hard documentation, do they? It's all online, it's all electronic.
Yes.
This is one of the big concerns, isn't it?
It has become much easier than it was before to fill in this document. Yeah. And they sometimes ask you for extra proof, but you just send it by email. And you can do it off any phone, I think just Androids, because you need to scan your passport. There's a little chip in your passport that...
Yeah.
Quite cool technology, but...
Was it quite straightforward, though?
Yeah, it was. Yeah. It didn't take too long. It's just, for example, I had to do mine for my mum, because her English is not yet on that level. She's been here 10 years longer than I have, but she's just really struggled to learn the language due to the work that she does, which is not speaking to people.
Yeah.
So...
Okay, so, but that your experience has been okay with that? I mean, do you have any concerns about that that whole scheme then, or do you think it's working? I mean, people have had quite a lot of time to do it, haven't they? And they still have another, over a year to kind of to go online. How long does it take?
I'd say 10 to 15 minutes.
Right.
Maybe a maximum half an hour if you need to double check. It's just the kind of the worry of having to fill in documents and then always to have to present that. So I've just rented a new place and I had to give a copy of that certificate, I think, which is new. Then my cousin's husband had an interview and they asked him, are you from EU? He's Asian, so he wasn't. But just kind of the worry, they're not sure of what's going to happen. Will we be allowed to stay? Or if we will be allowed to stay, will there be any rules and any conditions? And will we have to jump over any hoops or pay more money for things to have access?
And that's caused a lot of uncertainty, hasn't it? But
just worry. Not sure. Of course.
And I don't think that's widely understood, because we're talking about a lot of people, aren't we? There's a lot of EU citizens in the UK, and so we're not hearing from them enough, I don't think.
Mostly from people who work in factories in East London, are mostly from Europe. People who are picking strawberries and doing all the farm jobs, a lot of them are from Eastern Europe. And no, you don't get to hear much from them, because I guess, especially after Brexit, I'm not sure how people feel about speaking out for themselves. Like, we're watching on the news what's happening to Windrush people who've been here much longer. Yeah. And if that's how they're treated, then, you know, what right do we have?
Yeah, and I think that's a concern with the... not having hard copies of documentation, because I know that the withdrawal bill was going through Parliament, I know there was a push by the House of Lords to ensure that people had hard copies of documents for this registration scheme for EU nationals, but it's all electronic, and I can see where that would be a worry, because with the Windrush scandal, it was all about people having hard copies of documents, wasn't it? That's where people fell down, because they didn't have the documentation and they couldn't prove, even though they've been there for years.
Yeah.
You know? So do you, I mean, that's been the big worry for you then, and that's led you to trying to get a British passport, is that right?
I didn't feel so much as worried for myself. It was more for my family, that, you know, I don't speak much to people from our community, but my family does. They have friends and friends' friends, and there's just been so many kind of not gossip as such, but just people's fears, which there was no factual things, so people could make up anything, and those worries resonated within the whole community of what's going to happen. So yeah, I decided myself to, because I still have so much to, that I want to do and just stay here, that it's just easiest to go get the passport. But when I say easiest, it's going to cost me about £2,000,
yeah.
Which is for someone who, you know, as we were new to the country, we didn't have any financial help or support. Most of our money goes on rent, as yeah. We don't own anything in this country. £2,000 is a lot of money to pay for a passport. And it's really strange for myself, because I've been lucky enough to be put not within the communities where most of Lithuanians and people from your countries are. I've been in English communities. So to me, who all my friends are English, and I'm the only one who's having to kind of go through this worry and through having to pay for a passport, it just feels really strange, because I feel so English. I don't feel any different from anyone else who's here. So it's strange to even think that I have, this is kind of the rules that, due to political circumstances, we have to go through.
Yeah, and I can see that, having worked abroad myself in Brussels, European Parliament, for 3 years, it's kind of, when you go abroad, it's it was weird, really. I just went there, rented out a place, didn't really have to register for a while, actually. I seem to remember. It's just like you got a train, rented some, you didn't have to really do any bureaucracy, because that's the benefit that freedom of movement brought. So, I mean, how do you feel about freedom of movement ending then at the end of this year? If they manage to get a new system up in place, that is.
To be honest, I think freedom of movement has its own benefits and negatives, of course. There has to be rules on it, and there has to be regulations, and you do have to check. To be honest, I'm not a fan of British benefit system. I don't think it's good for anyone to be able to kind of wiggle their way out of working and receive more from the government than they would at a minimal pay job. And I think that did attract a lot of wrong people, whether it was from EU or the rest of the world, to kind of cheat and prod their ways and make money out of the government and people who are working. And I think that's what kind of gave a bad name for a lot of people who came here. Therefore, the freedom of movement didn't work for as much goodness as it could have. And now we're going to the Australian point base, which will very much limit the majority of people who come here for the minimal jobs, you know, for the cleaning and the jobs that would be avoided by...
It'll be partly point-based, won't it? Because there's going to be this income threshold which could impact upon Brighton I think it's just under 26K. But it'll be partly point-based, partly based on income.
That's
coming to play. So... how's it been so far for applying for citizenship then? Because we've heard a lot about the famous citizenship test.
Yes, well, David Cameron made himself a little bit of a fool on TV, not being able to answer. So I've just got this book, which is the Life in UK test. There's two tests I have to take. One is
show
English
it up to
test.
The camera.
So here's the Life in UK.
And you need to buy the book to do this famous test.
So on the website, they say that you do. But really, it's in every single library. I got this from Epsom Library.
What?
For free for a month. So otherwise it's £12.50. The test is £50. And if you're not studied in the UK, then you'd have to take English test, which is about £150.
Yeah.
It's the naturalisation that costs most. So some of the questions, interesting to know. So you need to know the dates of keys, festivals and traditions, which you have to take some time to learn, as well as speciality foods that go with them. So what do you know about Hogmanay?
Okay, yeah, that's a Scottish festival.
Which is? What festival is that?
Well, it's New Year's festival.
Yes.
Yeah.
And it's sometimes bigger than Christmas. I was hoping you might not know that.
Yeah.
Okay, joke on me. Right. So, I had one about inventions, which I've now lost the track of.
Okay, so what does it cover, the book? It covers, I've had a quick flick through, so the first time I've seen it, to be honest. It covers what? The political system,
the royal family,
traditions, customs.
Yes.
immigration law as a big
and inventions.
Yeah.
So you have to know 10 top British inventions, for example, the television and the World Wide Web was developed by a British man, and as well as their names and dates and things that make Britain and British people proud, I guess.
Yeah.
And
is it interesting reading that then, and do you think it's necessary?
I'm actually very interested to read it. I've not started yet fully, but I think this should be something that every British person would know, not just people who want to stay in the UK.
Yeah.
And I'll definitely use it to my advantage to question some of my British friends.
Yeah, exactly. So you think that's a good thing then in practice, the test?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
I think if you want to live in a country, you should know the kind of customs. But the fact is, most people who are born in a beautiful, cultured country don't know much about themselves. For example, I didn't know much about my country where I come from, in Lithuania, until I had some friends who I took over to Lithuania to kind of show my country.
You're right there.
I learned so much more about my country, you know? And I think
exactly, because you think you know it, and so you don't go out of your way to learn about it. Mm. But I think you're very, because when I lived in Brussels, I went around Belgium, very easy to travel around Belgium, and I saw a lot of Belgium, which actually my Belgian friends hadn't seen, and they were kind of going with me, saying, "Oh, right, I'm learning." So I think you're definitely right there.
Yeah.
And so that's always a good thing, isn't it? Mm. So we'll just finish up then. I mean, when's your test? I mean, all the best with that. It's coming up.
Thank you. It's 1 month's time. Yeah.
So it's next April. Okay. We'll get you back in and see how you did. I'm sure you're going to pass with flying colours, Helen.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
And thanks for coming in. All the best with that. And catch up soon. Thanks.
Thank you.